Today is July 23, 1996. We are interviewing Eva Safferman Zisman. My name is Barbara Johnson. We're in Fairlawn, New Jersey, United States of America. The language of the interview will be English. My name is Barbara Johnson. Today is July 23, 1996. I'm conducting an interview of survivor Eva Zisman Safferman. We're in Fairlawn, New Jersey, United States of America, and the language will be English. Spelling of the names are Johnson, J-O-H-N-S-O-N, Safferman, S-A-F-F-E-R-M-A-N. Tell me your name, please.
My name is Eva Safferman.
And your maiden name?
Zisman, Z-Y-S-M-A-N.
Where do you live?
I live in Fairlawn, New Jersey, 7 Sandow Court.
What is your date of birth?
April 15, 1928.
Do you know what day?
No, I don't.
Where were you born?
In Lodz, Poland. L-O-D-Z, Poland, P-O-L-A-N-D.
And your father's name?
Zachary. I have to spell it?
If you'd like, thank you.
No. You would like it? Z-A-C-H-A-R-Y.
What did your father do?
My father was an accountant and a businessman.
And did he own a business?
Yes, he did.
What type of business?
I think it was some kind of clothing place, manufacturing plant.
What kind of clothing?
I believe it was men's clothing. Yeah, I think pants or something like this.
And what did he do in his accounting business? What kind of people did he service?
He serviced a very, very large company which was doing the tar for the roofs in Poland. It's one of the biggest company. I think it was Oppenheimer was the name of the company.
Was it a Polish company?
I think the owners were Jewish.
And when was your father born?
I believe he was born in 1903. I don't remember the month.
Did you have brothers and sisters?
No, I was the only child.
What did your father like to do?
Well, I really don't remember that well. I was kind of young. But he used to take me out. He used to bring me stuff, food, all the best things when they weren't available to everybody else. I used to have them.
When was that, that they weren't available?
Oh, this was already when the war broke out.
What year?
It was about 1939.
What was your house like?
Well, we had a very nice apartment with a terrace. It was in a building that my grandfather owned, which my father really financed. And we had a very nice apartment, 2 bedrooms and kitchen. We were few the lucky ones. They had a bathroom in the house. Not too many people in Lodz had it.
What was the street that you lived on?
Poludniowa 94. P-O-L-U-D-N-O-W-A 94.
And what was your mother's name?
My mother's name was Anna. Before the war, they called her Hanka. Hanka Zisman, born Berman.
And what was her date of birth?
Mother was born in, I believe, in December 1998.
What did she look like?
She was a very pretty woman, dark hair, very nice.
What did she do?
She was a homemaker. She was home, just taking care of the three of us.
And how did she do that? Did she cook wonderful things?
Well, she had a maid, but she did the cooking.
What sorts of things?
Well, for Saturday she would make gefilte fish. She would cook, chicken soup, Traditional Jewish food.
And your maid, or the maid
Right.
that was in the
she
house,
was,
did she live with you?
No, she used to come in the morning and leave at night.
What was her name?
Oh, I don't remember. I think it was Marisha. I'm not sure, but I believe so.
Did you have one maid for as long as you can remember?
I remember, yeah, she used to tell me stories and used to sing to me, and then I used to get scared sometimes because she used to tell me those scary stories.
How old were you then?
Oh, that time I was maybe 8.
Did your mother have any hobbies or interests?
Yes, she liked to embroider. She liked to make beautiful pictures. The house was full of embroidered stuff that she made, pictures, tablecloth, just very, very talented this way.
How did she do them?
By hand.
Did she draw a picture first, or?
I really don't recall. But sometimes you buy a ready-made, and then she would just embroider them.
Was your family religiously observant?
My grandparents were very, very religious. My father was not as religious.
And your mother?
And my mother, she had to do whatever, you know, her husband, she had a kosher home, but she was religious. My father was the one that was a little bit lax, because sometimes he had to go into work on a Saturday. And of course, I was very heartbroken because I didn't like that all my friends were very religious. Sometimes it's to cry because my father turned on the light on Saturday.
Did you have many friends?
Yeah, I had friends, children that lived in the same house, the same building. We used to play together. I used to have a bicycle. I used to let him ride my bicycle because this was kind of luxury before the war.
The city in which you lived was a large city?
Yes, it was a large industrial city. Like New York is in the United States, that was Lodz was in Poland.
Did you attend school?
Yes, I did.
Where?
I went to public school on Magistratska 18, and then the war broke out.
In what grade were you when the war did break out?
I believe I was in the sixth grade, because I think I skipped. I don't remember really.
What sorts of things did you study in school, do you remember?
Arithmetic, Polish, spelling, geography. It was kind of a long time ago.
You speak other languages now. Did you learn them in school or afterwards?
Not in Poland, no, afterwards.
Did you have religious training?
Well, my mother took a rebbetzin for me, so gave me some instructions how to read, but I wasn't too good in it. I used to memorize one story because the rebbetzin used to get me to read a love story she had in the back of her book. And I learned one by heart. And every time she asked me, and I wanted to read this one till she got wise to me, she says, read something else. I couldn't.
Did your family take vacations?
Yes, yes. I used to go with my mom in a spa before the war. We went to Szczawnica, which was a resort in Poland.
Where was it? On the
ocean? In the mountains.
On the ocean?
Yeah. So no, it was in the mountains. It was beautiful there. I was a little girl, I remember. They used to have like a goat, and they used to milk the goat, and I would drink the goat milk. It was really nice.
You told me about a camp that you went to with your aunt one summer.
Oh, this was, I was a very poor eater, and like always so green, I didn't want to eat. So my mom decided that she sent me away with my aunt, which was my aunt Manusha, to a camp so I should learn how to eat. And I did go to the camp the same year that the war broke out. I did learn how to eat, but unfortunately when I got back, there wasn't too much to eat.
How did they teach you how to eat?
Well, no, just being with other children, seeing that they eat, and you know, it was different. Home I was by myself, and I, you know, please swallow. My mother used to run after me with a spoon. But over there with other children, I just really learned how to eat. And I guess I was getting older too.
Did you have pretty clothes?
Yeah, I had dresses, I had patent leather shoes, yeah.
Do you remember your favorite dress?
No, honestly, I don't.
You mentioned that you came back from camp and the war broke out. What sorts of things let you know that there was a war?
Well, there was a first of all, we had to put on a Jewish star. We weren't supposed to be in the street up to a certain hour. We were not supposed to go all around. You know, we just had to be stayed wherever we were. This was still in Lodz, not in the ghetto yet. But of course, already things were getting tough. You couldn't get food as much as you wanted to. And my father used to be a good provider, but still there wasn't too much to be gotten. So,
How did you hear about events?
well, we heard it. I mean, people were talking, and my father used to read the paper, and we had the radio, and you heard what happened because the war broke out, and in 3 days we were already occupied by the Germans.
Was your father allowed to have this radio?
No, he was not. This was against the law. If they would found it, they would have probably executed him or punished him in some way.
Was family life any different at this stage than it had been?
Well, my mom already took all the jewelry and started hiding it in the stove. She took out the brick from the stove and took all her jewelry because she had quite a lot that my father gave her. And she used to hide it. Every time, you know, she heard somebody might be coming, she used to hide it away. So it was kind of very unsettling.
What kind of jewelry did she have, do you
Oh
remember?
yeah, she had a diamond ring, she had a beautiful diamond watch that he bought her once for her anniversary. And he even bought a diamond ring for me. He says I should have that.
And you said you'd hear people coming.
Well,
Who?
the German people. They used to come to the houses and they used to inspect the houses. And then one day, we heard a big commotion outside, and there was a lot of Germans. They came into the house, and my mother heard it too. They went to my grandfather's house and they took everybody out, my grandmother, my grandfather, all the aunts and uncles, and they shipped them out. So when my mother saw that, she went into the house and started packing all this a little stuff that we had. She put some in valises, and we were staying by the door when the German officer came in, and he asked my mother, "What are you doing here?" So she says, "Well, I see that you taken away my in-laws and all my brother and sister-in-laws. Then I'm ready to go too." So he comes over and looks at me, and then he says, "Oh boy, is she Jewish?" And my mother says, "Yeah, she's Jewish." So he says, "You go back. You're not going any place." So then we stood, we remained in our apartment, but all my aunts and uncles and my grandmother and grandfather was evacuated.
Did you ever
And
see
we
them
never,
again?
no. We heard that they were taken to Stary Sącz. And I think they were executed there.
Why did the German officer, soldier, ask if you were Jewish?
I guess because I didn't look Jewish. I had blue eyes and I had red hair.
What happened next?
Well, next we just unpacked everything again. My mother, before we were ready to, she left the window open because my father wasn't home. And so this way he could come back and take out the stuff that she hid in that stove. But then so we went back in and we just stood on.
Did you have cousins who were evacuated as well?
No, at that time, no. No, I didn't have any cousins. I had one cousin, which this cousin left for the United States before the war. And of course, other cousins, there were some were in Israel and some were in a different town. They did not live, all of them did not live in Lodz.
what was the next thing that happened to your family in terms of the war?
The next time there was, we were supposed to leave our home and we were supposed to go into the ghetto. So that time my father came back and we packed everything, whatever little we could, and we marched with everybody else into the ghetto.
Do you know where your father had been? You say he came back.
Oh, he was doing business. He was still doing business during the war. He would take up the Jewish Star and he would go and do conduct business.
What did this Jewish Star look like?
It was a yellow, like a mug and David, like a Jewish Star, and inside it was written in black, Yude, which means Jew.
And were these stars supplied to you?
Yeah, you bought them, yes.
You had to buy them?
Yeah.
Do you remember how much they cost?
No, I can't remember, no. I really don't remember that much.
Were they sewn onto your clothing?
Yeah, we had to sew it on ourselves. So then we all marched to the ghetto, and my father got us an apartment.
Did you take things with you?
Yeah, we took a little things with us. We couldn't take too much. Some clothes, some bedding, a couple of pots, I guess, pens.
Food?
No, I don't remember, but maybe we did. I don't remember that.
Did you march alone or with other people?
Well, other people marched too. Everybody marched toward the ghetto. And you
were there people directing the march?
No, we just walked by ourselves. It was a part of the lodge that I was never before there. This part was like a poor part of lodge. So we went there, we got an apartment. It was one big room and a kitchen. And I had a grandmother which was in a nursing home at that time in Poland. So my mother took her mother out and she lived with us. And of course, it was the great hunger. We had very little to eat. And there was rationed, everything was rationed. Like we'd get 1 ounce of kohlrabi and then maybe bread for the whole family for the whole week. But she stayed with us till one day my father brought some horse meat that he got because he worked he was an accountant in the ghetto by Rimkowski. So he was able to get this. And when she saw this, and she said, my dear children, I can't stay with you anymore because I cannot stay and eat this non-kosher food. And the nursing home was still in existence, so my father had to take her back.
Why had she been in a nursing home?
Why?
Yes.
Because my grandfather, when he passed on, he said to her, I don't want you to be, you have 8 children, but I never want you to be with any of them. And he felt that she would be better off being in a nursing home. And she was very happy there. I remember even before the war, in the beginning, I used to bring her some food every Saturday. And I used to talk to all the ladies. They used to send, you know, save for me chestnuts because they liked me. I always used to come like the Little Red Riding Hood. With the food for her grandmother.
How old was she?
Oh, grandma was about 89 or so, 90, like this.
What became of her?
Well, she was very lucky because grandmother died natural death about a week, or maybe it was a couple of weeks before the German came to the nursing home. They murdered all the people in the nursing home. So she was really lucky that she got buried in her old, I don't know whether you know what tachrichim are. This is special clothes that you bury religious people. And she also had a little bag of sand that was sent to her from Israel.
Buried with her?
Yeah.
Were you able to go to the burial?
No, I didn't go. I guess in Poland there was a custom that if you have your parents, you weren't supposed to go to a funeral.
Was that a Polish or a Jewish custom?
It's a Jewish custom. When you have living parents, you're not supposed to go to the cemetery. Even when they say the holy prayer, when there was Iskir, you have to get out because if you had living parents. Now, they don't believe this anymore. They tell you you can stay on even there is the prayers.
Did your mother go and
father? Yes, she did.
So they were still able to leave the ghetto?
Well, this was in the ghetto. This was the cemetery was in the ghetto. Was in a part. It was called, I think, Mauritian. I'm not sure, but it was in the ghetto.
Was the nursing home in the ghetto as well?
Yes, it was. Yeah.
And they were able to maintain kosher.
They did.
In the nursing home.
Yeah, but she didn't stay too long there because she passed on, which was really lucky for her. She at least we knew where she was buried.
What did you do in the ghetto? Did
Me,
you go to school?
I went to school, yes. I went to school for a short while, and then they just closed all the schools and everybody had to go to work. So they sent me to a place that was making carpets, which was a tapir resort. It consisted, we had like a frame with some kind of a cotton going through, and we used to get pieces of material and make long pieces of material, and then we used to weave it in and make designs. They really came out quite nice. The only thing, sometimes we got stuff from people that were evacuated, and we saw there like three shirts one into the other, because a lot of people, when they were shipped out of the ghetto, would wear a couple of things, you know, one on top of the other. So when they were undressing and were taking away the clothes, one wasn't the other, and one of the women recognized her cousin's clothes. So we knew that the people that were evacuated, there was really, probably weren't alive anymore.
You told me that some of the clothing was bloodstained.
Right, some of the clothing was bloodstained. The time in the ghetto was the worst part of our lives, because we lived in constant fear. We never knew when there's going to be an appel and when they're going to take people off the streets. You were never sure where you're going to be when they're going to catch you, and that's what happened to my father. He was once walking in the streets, and they caught him on a truck and with a lot of other people, and he had no chance, and they just evacuated them and shipped them. We never heard of them again.
Do you know where they shipped him to?
No, we don't. We don't know.
And he was gone, and it was...
He was gone, and this was the last day I ever heard of him.
It was you and your mother?
That was me and my mother that was left.
Did you remain in the same place that you had originally been living?
We stood there for a little while, and then they decided they have to concentrate people in smaller places because they need more room, and they put me and my mother into another couples with a daughter in their apartment. So they gave us a bed on the site, and they hated us like it was our fault that they put us into their houses. But it really, you know, was not our fault. We didn't want to leave our house.
The Germans put you into it.
The Germans, yeah. This was really the Jewish government on the instruction of the Germans, because they told them what to do.
When you say the Jewish government, the government that existed within the ghetto?
Right, yes. There was a government, there was policemen, there was a whole body, like the president was Rumkowski, and he has a lot of people. Like my father worked for them too before they caught him, and no matter what he said, they just, you couldn't talk to anybody. They just put you in a truck and just evacuated you.
So the theys were...
There were the people that were issuing all kinds of rules that we had to obey, even though it was just... the German that told the Jews what to do. So we had to go to the other people's apartment.
What were the names of these people?
I really can't recall.
And but there was a father, mother, and a
and
child,
a, daughter.
A daughter.
And they were very mean to us. They put us, our bed on the place where there was, the water was coming down when the drains, and once my mother and me had to sleep with an umbrella, holding the umbrella up. And it was really very tough times, because every time that the people came, that we heard that the Germans are coming to look for people, we used to hide in a little, there was a little tiny, it wasn't like a little house, but with one room, more like a storage room, that me and my mom used to hide when we heard that the Germans were coming. So we were laying underneath a headboard under the window, so when the Germans would look in, they wouldn't see us. So that's how we were hiding, you know.
Did the people that you were staying with eventually get taken away?
I don't remember that because we left before that.
Where did you go?
Well, as I told you, I was working in the carpet factory, and then after a short while, they disbanded it and sent all the young children to a other factory, in a factory that were making, I believe was uniforms for the Germans. And we worked there. And from there, there was the German asked the director of this factory occasionally to give him names, people they should evacuate. And one day there was a list, and my name was on this list. And I knew that I have to hide unless they come and look for me. I had an uncle which was a policeman in the ghetto. So when I saw the name, I went to him and I asked him, please, could you do something? You know, the director of the place, they should take off my name from the list. And he did, and he managed to take off my name, but unfortunately for me, my name was typed twice, and the other name was still on this list. And one day they came to look for me. We were in this little place that we were. This was a couple of apartments were spread out, and we had a little bit of ground in the back. And all the tenants used to divide a little piece of ground, and we used to put some, grow some vegetables, radishes, beets, cucumbers. And we also had three fruit trees, which really helped us in the ghetto. But so we used to divide whatever fruit would grow against the tenants, and everybody got a little bit. And one day when I was in the back there, I heard somebody come in and yell, Eva Zisman. And I had a bad feeling about it because I knew my name was on the list. So I ran in the back and I lay down between the beets, and I covered myself with the beets.
The beet leaves were big enough to cover you.
Oh, yes. I put it all around, and they came to my mother and asked her, where is Eva? And she says, I don't know. I don't know where she is. So they said, well, we're going to wait. So I says, I don't know how long it's going to take when she comes. But she says, here, she gave him a bag of apples. Please write down that she's not here. So, okay, they took the apples. They went away. And this was the first time that this saved me.
Take two, interview of Eva Safferman. Your mother gave apples to the soldiers.
No, these were the Jewish policemen, the Jewish capo, the Jewish policemen in the ghetto, yeah.
And you called them the capo?
Well, no, not the capo, not yet. Not in the ghetto, no. They were not capos, they were just policemen. Yeah, and there was a lot of hunger. There was a lot of people were very hungry. I remember my cousin came to the house. I don't remember her name, or was it an acquaintance? And she was all swollen from hunger. It was just impossible. People were eating anything. They made pancakes from grinds of coffee grinds, from beets, leaves, from anything they could. It was really very bad. People were really starving and hungry.
How did you cook things?
Whatever little we had, they cooked. I don't remember. My mother used to cook. I was too
there
young.
There was a stove and
there was a
fuel.
Stove, yeah. So going back to the family that we lived with,
right?
They were very mean to us because when my mother, when after they finished their cooking, they would put water on the fire, and my mother had to start from scratch. It was really very bad. So after a few more times when they came, and the next time my mother gave him some rice, which my father was my uncle from America. My uncle left to America in 1939, and he sent us two packages to the ghetto. And because my father worked there, he was able to get those packages. And in one was some cocoa, some rice, even some butter, which was fresh. And really, this my mother's used it so sparingly that we had it for a long time. So once she gave him some rice, and they left again. But it got to be so very often that we were just exhausted. We were just, the war of nerves was worse than anything else. We couldn't stay there anymore. Between the appels and people looking for me, we had an aunt that lived on the other side of the ghetto. The ghetto was divided by a bridge. And this aunt said, "Okay, you can come, you and your mom." I mean, to my mother, she says, "You and your daughter can come and stay with us," even though she knew that if she would have been, if they would find us there, she would have been executed. But she took us to her house and we stayed there with them. And during the day, we used to hide. We used to go to the cemetery, sleep there, or we used to hide someplace in the attic. And one day when we came back, sure enough, the door was open and the Germans were there looking for us. And
Now it was the Germans looking for you, no
there was a
longer
German that time.
the Jewish
They were
police.
coming, not the Jewish police, this was the German.
Were there
And
ever Polish police or soldiers that you
no,
saw?
not in the ghetto. No, not in the ghetto. Well, they all became Reichsdeutschen. All of a sudden, the Polish became German. I don't know. Yeah. And where was I? Oh, we were in my aunt's
And
house, and we used to have rationed bread. And I had a little cousin, and he always used to run, and he used to go and bring the bread, stay in line. He used to organize, bring some food, some vegetables that he used to bring. A little boy, he was maybe 5 or 6. So my mom said to me, well, one day she says to me, why don't you go and stay in line, and you bring the bread? So I took the carts, the rations, and I went. It was about a couple of blocks over, and I stood in line. There was a big line, and we were waiting for the bakery to open. And the people were saying, oh, it doesn't matter. The other day was also a very big line, but then the German came, and everything was in order, and everybody got a bread. But then all of a sudden, I saw from far away, I saw some tanks coming on, and I had a very bitter feelings. And I said to myself, Eva, you better get away from here. And I ran away from the line, and I went to a house that was right around the corner. And when I walked into the house, there was a lot of people there hiding. And I said to myself, this is no good, too many people. And as I glanced across the street, I saw there was a little house with also a little garden. And I didn't think twice. I went to that garden, and lucky for me, there was beets again. And I lay down between the two, I don't know how you call those
the rows of beet
rows of
plants.
beet plants. And I lay down and I cover myself. And there was another woman with a little boy, and she saw me doing it, and she did the same thing. And she lay down not far from me. And it didn't take maybe 2 minutes that you heard the Germans came and started grabbing people, putting on those trucks. And in that building that I was, you could hear the screams, Shema Israel, and people were crying
What
and
does that mean?
screaming, listen, God. They usually say that before they die, and this is the prayers. And the people were taken all from that building. Every one of them were taken on trucks and taken away. And one German assessment or so went to the house when I was hiding there, jumped over the vegetable things, and he didn't see us. And he went out, and I was just praying to God. I said, God, I don't mind, but I want to be with my mother. If I die, I should be with her. I didn't want to be by myself. And I prayed to God, and I was sitting there, and after a little while, it got quiet. The trucks went away, and I was laying there. After about an hour or so, when it was very quiet, I heard some steps, and I looked out from the vegetables garden. And there was a man, it was a policeman that lived in this house that would have accounted for that he still had vegetables in his garden because most people didn't have anything. And I asked him, is it okay to go home? And he says, no, you stay there. So I stood there, and sure enough, another half an hour, when people started coming out, The Germans came back again and grabbed all the people from the street. When it was getting really dark, he came and he says to me, "Okay, now you can go home."
The policeman came.
The policeman, the Jewish policeman.
What happened to the woman and her child?
She ran away. She went away before. I don't know what happened to her. But she had really me to thank because I gave her the idea of hiding in between the vegetables.
Those must have been some big beet leaves.
Yes, they were. They were beautiful because the Polish earth was very rich. You know, the vegetables, you don't see vegetables and fruit the way you saw in Poland. They were really very, very beautiful, fruitful, and very delicious too. They really, you don't see tomatoes that tasted like, I don't know whether Poland has the same thing now, but that time they did.
Not even in New Jersey?
Not even New Jersey. No, it was really. So I was running home, and when I came home, everybody was crying because they thought I was already gone. Except my mom. She started crying when she saw me.
What about your little cousin?
And my little cousin was there too. He was also crying. Everybody thought I was gone, that they took me away from the street. But I was lucky once again.
When was this?
This must have been maybe in August, because we were another month and we couldn't stand it anymore. The daily, you know, it was terrible.
August of what year?
And this was in 44.
So you'd been in the ghetto for?
Three years. Three years, I think.
You had a job at one time where you talked about pulling.
Oh, this was in that place where they put my name on the list. I was pulling those little
threads
from the garments. It was really not, you know, they just wanted to keep us occupied. So we decided that we can't stay in the ghetto anymore. So my aunt and my little cousin and me and my mom, we decided to give ourselves up. And this was in September. And we went to the train station. And there was, I think, was already from the last people, because there was only a handful of people that still remained in the ghetto. So they put us on the trains. They put us in the trains. They stuffed us like animals. There was no room to breathe. One was on top of the other. People was dying of thirst and screaming and yelling. And it was raining, and I had a little cup. So I put it out, and I took some rainwater, and I gave it to my mom, and I gave it to some people around. I don't know how hygienic this was, but it helped a lot of people.
You say life in the ghetto had become so severe that anything was better than staying there. Was there any kind of activity that was fun in the ghetto? Was there singing?
Fun?
Reading?
Well, I used to read a lot, but it was not compulsory. You know,
right.
I used to be an avid reader. I used to go to, I don't remember where I got the books, but I did read a lot. But there wasn't, not really. After the school ended, we went to work. It was just a day-to-day survival. It was just hunger and fear.
Was there religion at all?
I don't recall any. Maybe some people that were religious, they still were, but where I was, I don't remember anybody that was really religious.
There was no opportunity, no one.
No, there was no place where to go. I mean, who, when I remember, this was when the war broke out, I saw the Germans grab a Jew by the beard and tearing it off. It was a horrible sight that we saw. They took little kids and they would knock their heads against the wall. I mean, even if you were religious, you had to hide it. You couldn't show it because your life was in danger. You couldn't.
Let me take you back just briefly to the time before the ghetto.
Yeah.
Were there incidents that occurred in the street?
Yeah, this is the incident that carried, this
I
was
see.
Before the ghetto, right? What I just told you about the beard being pulled off this Jew's, you know, the whole beard from his face.
Was just grabbed
just
and
terrible.
Pulled.
Just grabbed and pulled him. It was just too horrible to remember and to think. That's why I, like, distanced myself.
And like children were hit. You were never hit, though.
No, I was lucky. I really was. I was never hit. I never...
You're on a train.
Yeah, we were on a train, and we were on a train for a long time, and then we arrived to Auschwitz. And we looked out, and I saw a lot of people running around with striped uniforms. I said, "Well, what's going on here? They look like they from some kind of inmates or something." So we went to. They told us, they opened the doors, and they told everybody to get off. So we got off the train, and I was with my mother, my aunt, and that little cousin, and I don't know, some neighbors or something, I don't know. But going halfway through, I told my mom, "You know, mom, I think we left the passport on the train." And I left a little pot, a little pot, because we won't have where to cook something. So my mom went with me back to the train, and my aunt and my little cousin went with the rest of the people. And that's the last we saw them, because of my little cousin who was so young, my aunt went with him. And when I came with my mom, we didn't see any more. I saw my other aunt. There was my other aunt from my father's side, was with a little tiny baby also. And she also went with a little baby. They all went. We didn't know where they went, but they went to one side and we went to another side.
And what happened to them?
They were all burnt because this was one more, the last day that they were allowed to burn when we came to Auschwitz in 44.
Why were they not allowed to burn?
Because there was, I don't know, there was some kind of a the German got from Berlin. They told him no more burning. I don't know what the reason was, but it was no in Auschwitz. But we didn't know about that. So me and my mom, we were looking for them, but we couldn't find them. So we just went on the side that we were supposed to walk. And my mom, because of this laying on that cement floor, developed some kind of I don't know how you call it in English, but
Say it in Polish.
zapalenie stawów. That means inflammation of the joints. And so she was walking with a cane. And as we were walking, there was one German that came over and called me and my mother because I was limping. I had polio when I was a little girl. So I was limping and my mother was walking with a cane. So he called us out from the line and he says, "You stay on the side here." So my mother said, "Okay." So I said to my mom, "Mom, I really don't want to die. I'm so young, and it was so beautiful. You know, the scenery was breathtaking there in Auschwitz,
How
the
old were you
green."
then?
I was 11. And I said, "I really didn't live any. I would like to live a little longer." And my mother says, "Don't cry, my child." She says, "We should be the victims for all the people they are around here. If we should die in order the others should live." And we were staying there. And everybody was almost gone. We were staying too, and there was a couple of officers that came over. And he comes and asks my mother, "What are you staying here?" And my mother says, "The other officer told us," in perfect German, she spoke perfect German, says, "The other officer told us to stay on the side." So he looks at me and looks at me and looks at my mother. And I guess, you know, must have been, you know, my eyes, it was so blue, and I really.
You were a very beautiful child.
I was, yeah, and he says to me, "Go and spot." So we went, and when we came, all the people were so happy to see us because they were sure that we were already sent to the oven. And sure enough, my aunt with my little cousin Judith was sent to the oven. And then they took us, and they said we go in and spot into the bath, and we had to get undressed. And my mother still had that little bundle of the jewelry with her. And she was going to give it away. And I said, "No, Ma, I don't want to give him nothing." So I made a little hole in the ground and I buried it. I wanted to take, she had one big diamond to hide it. My mother says, "Enough. I don't want anything anymore. This way we're not going to live in fear." So I took all this thing and I buried it. Probably somebody already got it after the war. They knew a lot of people did it. So they took us and they shaved us all around. And I was staying next to my mom, and I didn't even know. I said, "Ma?" And she says, "Yeah, that's me." And we went into the bath, and luckily it was not gas that came out, but water. And after the bath, we went out, and they gave us clothes. They didn't look what size, what you got a pair of shoes, and they threw you a dress, and they threw you a coat, and they threw. So we got dressed, and I got a pair of shoes with heels like this, and I didn't know what to do. I couldn't wear it. So my mother had her shoes that she had it from the ghetto, that, you know, like very soft because she had trouble. And this woman, this was a capo. She was, I think, a Czechoslovakian capo. She took her shoes and she threw it down the hill. And when I saw this, I didn't even think twice. I ran down the hill and grabbed the shoe. I knew my mother wouldn't be able to walk without them. And I grabbed it, and I really risked my life, because if she saw me. But I got her back to shoes, and people were dying of thirst. It was such a hot day, and everybody was so thirsty. And they took the water hose, and she just spilled the water next to the people. But she wouldn't give anybody, just to, you know, to make us miserable.
When you say the kappa, was she Jewish?
Yes. She was a Jewish from, I think, Czechoslovakia. There was a few Czechs and a few Hungarian kappas. There were some Jewish, Polish Jews too. So then they got us together. We were in Auschwitz, and they said we have to, after the bath, when we have already stuff, and we were going to the next town, which was Birkenau. So we walked over there, and I heard somebody say to us, "Oh, you are lucky you're not going there where the dust is." So I said, "See, Ma, we're not going to work in the streets when it's all the dust. We're going to probably work in a factory when it's going to be clean." I didn't know what they meant, where it's the dust, that they meant we're going to get burnt and turn into dust. You know, we didn't know that. So we walked to Birkenau, and we stayed there overnight, slept maybe 500 women in one little cubby hall. And the next morning, they told us to stay in line. And we stood in line, and there were train coming on. And I was next to my mom, and they cut through the lines. One went to one train, and one to the other train. I immediately stood behind my mother, so I should be with her together. And we went on a train, and we started our journey to a working camp, which happened to be in near Hamburg. The name of it was Puppenbüttel Sassel. We went to this camp, and they gave us barracks, you know, like we were, I think, 16 women in one barracks. It was like bunk beds, and me and my mom got the lower bunk beds.
How large was the barrack room?
The barrack was small, but there was a lot of barracks. There was two big ones, and there was a number of small ones. One, ours was a small one. And we stayed in this barrack with those 16 other women, which fortunately quite a number of them are still alive.
And are you in contact with them now?
Yeah, we used to be after the war. We're still in contact with my friends, yes.
So you had friends while in the camp?
Yeah, we were together, yeah. I also forgot to tell you, while in Auschwitz, when we had to go to the bathroom, we were all staying in groups of five. You couldn't go to the bathroom when you wanted to. It's when they told you have to go. And if somebody was in the middle or nothing and they said this is finished, they had to get out. And I also forget to tell you yet, and this was this one day in that Auschwitz, when we came with my mom, we were staying in the barracks, and this one capo saw my mother with a cane. And she grabbed the cane and she says, you'll be better off without it. She grabbed the cane, and unfortunately she broke this cane on another poor woman's back when she couldn't hold, she had diarrhea. It was terrible. It was just unbelievable what we went through. I mean, you can't imagine.
What did you eat the camps?
In the camps? Well, we got, I think, one soup, a thin soup once a day, I remember. But in the working camp, we also got a bread for the 16 women.
What did you do in the working camp?
Oh, every morning they would send us in trains to Hamburg. So we had to run to catch the train. And it was a big walk and it was hard for my mother. So whenever I could, I would volunteer, I should go for her. But sometimes even she wouldn't even have to go, but I volunteered just to make sure that they don't take her. So we used to run and we used to go into Hamburg and we were staying by bumped out houses. And what we did, we stayed in a line. Like one would give a brick to the other. It was just, it was not really work. This was something to make us miserable. You know, so we one would give the brick to the other and we made a big thing. And overnight we came next day, the house was bumped again, we started anew. It was just to make us miserable. And then one day they took us to a different place. They said we should build something and I took a mortar and a brick and I was being a mason. But most of the time I really was hiding. My mother said, why don't you work? You're gonna get warm because it was very cold. And some people took the cement bags and put them in their bag to keep warm. But when the Germans saw it, they would really hit him very severely.
By now it was winter.
It was winter, yeah. And I was once hiding in a cement machine. And my mom says, you're gonna get killed. I said, no, I'm gonna be warm day. And I was hiding in that cement. Yeah, and this was in that working camp. And every day we used to come and they used to start counting us and we would stay for hours and they would count and they would count and they would count. And it was just miserable. And
why do you think they spared you? Why do you think they didn't just kill you?
Because it wasn't the time yet. They were still, the war was still on. They thought maybe, you know, they didn't want to kill everybody at once. I don't know why. But we had our, the guy that was in charge of the camp was a very educated German. He spoke Hebrew fluently. And he used to have music. When we used to come from work, there was music there.
No cocktails.
No, just music.
What was his name?
I don't remember. But there was a woman here that survived, that he really liked this woman. And he told her, if they ever gonna disband this camp, run and hide.
Were any of the women ever involved with him?
I guess she must have been. I don't know. Some people were lucky that, you know, that they got a job in the kitchen, so they had a little bit more soup. I was never lucky like this. Once me and my girlfriend went to steal the kohlrabi, you know, and I was holding her up, and she stole from the kitchen, and we brought it to, once we were almost caught by a German, I heard the steps, and I said to her, let's go, Helen. So I dropped her, and I ran, and then she ran after me, but we had that big vegetable, so we had it for a few days. And then I also forgot to tell you that we were very thirsty, there was nothing to drink in the camp that time. And my mom said, she's got a drink. So she said there was a bathroom and the water was running. And she said, she's gonna drink the water from the bathroom. And I said, Ma, you're not gonna do it. So she saw some puddle of water that was green. She wants to drink. I said, Ma, no, please. And I was walking by and I saw there two women were holding a pail with water going to the kitchen. And I took the little pot that I had and I put it in and I got some for my mother. I said, see, I didn't want you to drink this. God didn't want you to get sick from that water that was from the latrine.
What happened to your little pot?
I don't know. And also in that working camp, once a week we used to get a soup, a thick soup. That was once a month. It was a rice soup with milk. And I said to my mom, Mom, after the war, every day you're gonna cook me this soup. Because I had a strange belief all through the war that we're gonna survive. I just had a feeling that we're gonna survive.
And you were right.
And
did you ever eat rice and milk soup after the war?
No.
Or kohlrabi?
She was right. She was right. I never did. And there was a girl that used to cut our bread very, very evenly. This girl I met after the war in the street, I recognized her. Yeah. She's here in the United States too.
Where did you go next?
Well, we
Or
were,
what happened next,
what
perhaps?
happened next? When the German heard that they were beginning to lose, oh no, I forgot to tell you one also things. We were working, we went to a place that was like a Rinderhalle, it was like a slaughterhouse that we worked there. And I don't know what I should tell you about the incidents with the woman.
Oh, please.
Well, everybody of us had a coat, and inside was cut out a piece of material, and everybody had a different color, like in the back of their coats. And we were in the Rinderhalle, and there was a lot of cows and bulls. And I said to my mom, Mom, I'm going to, of course, with my little pot, I said, I'm going to go and I'm going to get some milk. You know, I'm going to go start, I know from milking a cow, like, you know, but I went. And we went, and another, it was a few other women that went. And we went over there, and I was looking for a cow to milk. And there was another woman, and she was next to a bull. And she had the misfortune of having a red piece of cloth in the back of her coat. And when she went to the cow next to the bull, of course, they're very protective, must have been his mate or something. And he charged at this woman. And he, you know, she opened her mouth to scream, and the bull just tore up her face. And I was next to it, and I started screaming, and I was running through the gates. I don't know what strength, God must have given me the strength to run over the big gates. And I was started running, please help, help, a woman is being hurt. And she's in trouble. And I ran and ran and jumped. And finally the people came and they pulled away this bull from her. But it was a terrible experience. I never forget. I don't know how I could run away.
Did she survive?
The woman survived, but the face was all with pus. And I don't know whether she survived the war, but immediately she did survive. And after this, when we went there, we were once sitting, and we were sitting there and by work, and a German came over there, and he comes to my mother and he says, is it true that you were all prostitutes? And my mother says,
I'm going to interrupt now.
Okay.
And
okay.
This is the end of tape two.
Okay, fine.
The beginning of tape three, interview of Eva Safferman.
Well, when that German man asked my mother, is it true that you were all prostitutes? My mother says, okay, I grant you, I might have been, but how about my daughter? She's just a child. How could she be anything? So he says, yes, I understand. And every day when we were walking from work to the trains, I would look and see buildings with lights in them, and people living like human beings. And I would think to myself, will I ever live like this? Will I always be walking around in five people in a row? Would it ever happen, you know? It was just like you weren't a human being. You were just part of a five.
And there were all women
all
in
women,
this camp.
Just women. Just women. We were just women.
You were an adolescent, but there were no boys around for you to talk to?
No, there was no boys, no men, nobody. No, it was just women. It was a lot of women. And what happened when there was one day we were on a working and there was an air raid. So they put us into a bunker and we were all hiding in that bunker, and there was this German with us. And you heard bombs falling all around us. And of course we were praying, you know, to God. And all through the war, I remembered my uncle's address, you know, from America. I don't know, I just remembered it. And when we walked out from the bunker after there was the all clear after the air raid, when we walked out, there was a bump in front of our bunk, a big hole in the back all around. And the German says, you know, it must have been because of you people that we were spared. And we went back, and then we heard that they said that they're going to close the camp.
What was the name of the, not the name of the commander, you didn't know that, but what did he look like?
Oh, German, I don't know, with a little mustache with glasses.
Tall, short?
Medium.
Medium build as well?
Yeah, because every day we used to stay, every morning and every night they used to count us. They used to count and count, and we were standing and standing. Some people, I was talking about that slaughterhouse. So there was a lot of, you know, like cows, sometimes they would lose their placenta. And this was meat, and people, women were eating it. So one woman once grabbed this piece of meat, and she hid it on her. And of course, when we were coming back, we used to be searched. And when we used to be searched, they found this woman dropped this piece of meat. So they saw the meat on the floor, so they started yelling, who dropped it? Of course, nobody would say who dropped it. And so we were standing a half a night. Some people already fainted, some women. So they were hit, and they had to get up again. And, you know, because they wanted to know who dropped this. So this was one of the worst nights that we had.
Did they ever find out?
No. No, nobody ever told us. That's why we had to stay almost all night long.
And were you ever hit?
No, I was never hit. My mother was, though. They found a little piece of a leaf of something that she had in her bag, and this Jewish copper hit her. Oh, I wanted to kill her, but I just couldn't do anything.
Same Czech woman that you spoke
to? No, this
before?
this was a Polish woman. Her name was Mirka. But she didn't really hit her death hard. She just was making believe because she was one of the good ones. And they decided that they going to ship us to take us out from Poppenbüttel, Sassel. So they put us on train, and sure enough, this woman that was a friend of this German tried to escape, but she had no place where to go, and after 2 days she submitted back to the camp. Yeah.
And they nobody allowed her to come back.
Yes, well, what else would they do with her? So we went on trains again, and we were going towards Bergen-Belsen. We were going on the train, and then they had to descend the train, and we went on a march. They used to call it Death March. We used to walk and walk, and on the way we saw some French soldiers and Italian soldiers. They were, some of them, if they had something, they would give people to eat, but we were walking and walking and walking. Some people couldn't walk, so they hit them over the head. And I don't know.
The Germans hit them?
Yeah, I don't know with what strength me and my mom walked. I really don't know.
How long did you walk?
Oh, it was hours that we walked. And coming, you know, we were still a while away from the camp, and my mom said to us, with the five, well, we always walked five, and she says, you know what, I smell dead bodies. And everybody said to my mom, you're crazy. And then we came into Bergen-Belsen, and the first thing we saw was a mountain full of skeletons. It was a sight that you could never forget. And from far you saw people dragging the skeletons, because everybody looked like death, you know, nobody. All you could see was bones. I looked at my mother, she was just all bones, everybody, you know. And we went, and they put us in one big room. And it was the whole camp in one room. Can you imagine this? I mean, we couldn't even move.
How many people? Any idea?
Oh, it must have been 500 or more.
You talked about the five of you, your mother, and three other women.
Three other women. There was every time somebody else, but you have to be five. You couldn't go any place unless you were five in a row. You couldn't. This was it. The only thing in the morning you could go to take a shower that has showers in the camp. But so we were there overnight.
At Bergen-Belsen?
At Bergen-Belsen.
How long did it take you to get there? How long were you marching?
Well, as I told you, I don't remember. I kind of blocked stuff out from my memory because it was easier this way. So we were in Bergen-Belsen, and at night I wanted to lay down. It was dark, but nobody would let me. And my mother was, I couldn't even get to my mother. And I laid down on a woman, and she says, Basha? And I said, yeah, because I, if she knew it was somebody else, she would have pushed me away. This way she thought it was a sister. She let me sleep almost on top of her, you know. So, and then in the morning, towards the morning, we heard somebody knocking at the door. And a woman yells, you want to hear about that?
Oh, yes.
The woman knocks on the door and she yells, this Jewish couple, her name was Mirka. And she says, Mirka, open the door. I'm having a baby. So everybody said, oh, she probably flipped out. She's crazy. I mean, how could she have a baby? And she insisted, please open it up. I'm having a baby. So they finally opened the door and they let her in. Sure enough, the woman was having a baby. Because from the time we came from the ghetto until we got to Bergen-Belsen, it was 9 months. And this woman was walking around. She's got a swollen stomach. And she's going to die because the stomach is grouching. And she hears noise in her stomach. And she's going to die. And she's... So this woman really had the baby. So she delivered the baby. And somebody had a rusted scissors. And they cut the umbilical cord. And they called the German. And they took her out. And I never forget this woman was laying there. They put her in some kind of bed. I don't know, it was in a different room. I don't know how I remember that. But they gave her a whole pail of soup and she ate the whole thing up. I don't understand how. I don't know what happened to the baby where they lived, because we weren't concerned with anybody else. Everybody was just to survive. And you know, everybody was really self-centered. Everybody wanted to survive. And many a times my mom would give me a piece of her bread, and I really shouldn't have taken it, but I did, because I was so hungry. But she would share anything with me.
You were lucky to be together.
Yeah, I was very lucky. And all the time I only prayed to God I should be freed on my birthday. And my wish was granted. We were freed on April 15, 1945.
Who freed you?
The English, the British. They came and they started saying hello, hello with those loudspeakers. We are here. The war is over, but you have to stay here another 3 days till we be able to get you out. And there was a lot of people that in those 3 days got killed because they ran to the gates, and the gates were still electrocuted. So they were just, you could see them stuck to the gates. And a lot of people were shot too. The Hungarian military was still around. And if somebody wanted to escape, they would shot them. It was just, a lot of people died yet. And I remember that the capo, the Czech capo, she liked me. And she knew it was my birthday, and she gave me an extra. There was a soup that we used to get still day one soup. And she gave it to me, and she says she wishes all my life I should have such lucky days as today. She was nice. She liked me.
What language did the soldiers tell you that you had been liberated in?
I think it was Polish. It must have been Polish and English and every language. They repeated it because there was a lot of inmates. We were not only Poles there. There were all kinds of, there were not only all Jews there, there was also Gentile people in this camp too. And we found out that the bread that they had in Bergen-Belsen had ground glass. That's what they were supposed to feed us with. And also that the camp was on a time bomb, which they didn't have time to execute because they ran away. As soon as they saw that the British arrived, all those Germans ran away and they just left us there. See, that they wanted to bomb us, not to leave any sign of their atrocities. You know, they wanted to hide it, but they didn't have the time because it was too late.
What had happened to the mountain of bodies?
Pardon me?
What had happened to the mountain of bodies that you first saw when you arrived?
They were still there.
How high was it?
There. Pardon me?
How high was it? You talked about a
Oh, there
mountain.
was, oh, very high, very high. I would say like 4 stories high. My husband was one of the ones that was dragging those bodies into the onto the mountains, so or into the hole. It was terrible.
Did you know your husband at that time?
No, I didn't. We
What happened after you were liberated? Where did you go?
after the liberate we were liberated, we stayed the 2 days, and then the British came, and people were running because there was places where there was watches and stuff that they robbed from the Jews. I only went to look a pair of shoes because I had no shoes, because I was a little girl. I didn't know to go for gold or for money or for jewelry. I went to look for a pair of shoes. But they put us into an apartments, houses, in nearby. People that were sick went to hospitals, and we went to the apartments there. And it's kind of unclear. I remember there was one British soldier gave me chocolate, and he liked me, and I told him that I lived someplace else because I didn't want him to come. Because I didn't, I was a young kid. I didn't want to have nothing to do with anybody. So we lived in this place in Germany, not far from Bergen-Belsen. And then we found out that people, they had diphtheria. My mother was sick. She got diphtheria, and we were also covered with lice, which was from hunger and from dirt, because we couldn't bathe or clean ourselves anymore. So we heard that they take people that were sick into Sweden. So my mom decided that we should go to Sweden. So we applied, and we got all our papers, whatever we had, and we were going on the way to Sweden. So whatever we had, they took everything away. They washed us, they quarantined us, and they gave us fresh clothes. And we went on a boat from Lübeck to Sweden. And we came to Malmö, and they put us into a museum because that was a big place, and we stayed there. Still unclear, I don't remember that much, but I remember from Sweden, I wrote a letter to my aunt and uncle in America. And they moved in the interim. And fortunately, a neighbor got the letter and met my uncle, and he gave him the letter, and immediately he sent a telegram to Sweden that he's happy that we are alive, and he's going to be looking for anybody else that's alive, and he's going to try to send us papers. We should come to America.
How did you feel then after the war had ended and you were in Sweden with your mother?
Oh, I felt great. I was happy. I knew that we're going to survive. I just knew it. I mean, I had such a strange, strong feeling that we're gonna survive. And I was with my mom, and after we were there about 2 weeks in Malmö, they sent us to Borås. This was a little, like a little seaside village in Sweden. And some people were put up in hotels, some people were put up in barracks. We were lucky, me and my mom stayed at a house of a director of the post office, and she was very good to us. She used to bring us breakfast in bed.
Was she Jewish?
No, she was not Jewish, but he liked us, and she really,
Do you remember their name?
I think her name was Svensson. I have someplace a picture of her, I don't know where it is now, but she used to, bring us treats, and after being there a short while, my mom went to a like convalescent home, and I went to school. We went to school, and we were like sleep. We slept there, and we lived there. We were in school, and we learned languages, English and Swedish, and arithmetic and Hebrew.
And you got to eat some food.
Oh yes, we got to eat some food. Yes, we did. We did. But
How long did you stay in Sweden?
I was in Sweden 3.5 years.
And did you meet someone there?
I met my husband in Sweden, yes. Yeah, we met in...
What's your husband's name?
Henry. He was in a place that was... in Sweden, they got like a pluga. Pluga is a place that they work together and they pull, like in Israel. They pull their earnings and they live together. Some people cook and some people go to work. And he stayed with them because he wanted to go to Israel with the rest of the other people. But then he met me and he changed his mind.
And decided to come to America?
Right, yes.
How did you arrange that?
We sent him after we were in America.
But no, how did you arrange to get him to America? Did you get married in Sweden or did you get married?
No, we got married in the United States. My uncle sent him papers. First he sent us the papers. But in Sweden, we had one of the happiest times of our life. We were really, really free of any worries, and was, the people were great, were very nice. Swedish people were wonderful. And I was in school, and on vacation, they used to send us to visit our parents. And once I got there, a letter from my mother, and it was addressed Congo. So I said, oh my God, they sent it to Africa? But this was Konga in Sweden, and I went to visit her. And she was doing quite well. And after being there and in school, I was about a year and a half, we went to work. So we went to, oh no, the place that we stayed after Malmo was Mele. This was a resort. And from Mele, we went to Borås. We went to school. To school, I was in Forsbacka. I think so. I'm not sure now. Yeah, I think so. And then we stayed in school. And we went skiing, and we had fun, and we were singing, and it was great. It was really nice. We had a great time.
And you had physically recovered?
Yes, everybody wasn't skinny like anything because we had food. We could eat as much as we could. Though I think Sweden still was didn't have everything as abundant that later on. The beginning was a little bit, but we still had food.
You learned that Henry had been at Bergen-Belsen.
Yes, Henry has been in Bergen-Belsen too.
At the same time that you were there?
Yes, he was freed also on my birthday. He was freed, but he was sick. He went to a hospital, I understand. He was very lucky to be alive, yes.
How did you get to America physically, by boat?
We went, under Grips home. Yeah, we went under Grips home. Me and my mom and my girlfriend that's here, and we went to under Grips home. And they were great. They went out and they ate and they took all the movies, and I was sick like a dog. After, you know, that I really could eat everything I could. I couldn't because I was seasick.
Oh.
But as a matter of fact, that steward that came in, he says to me, oh, you're just making it up, he says. So I said, if you only knew how I feel, you wouldn't say it. And the next day he comes with a long nose and he tells me, oh, you must have cursed me because the first time he's a seaman for 15 years and he was seasick.
Were the seas rough?
Right, a little bit.
What time of year was it?
We came in January. We came January 16, 1949. We came to the United States.
Where did you land?
We landed in New York. And my cousin Renee's husband, Dave, picked us up. And we went to the Bronx where my uncle lived. And we stayed with them for about 6 months.
That's the uncle who's 102
years old.
Who's
102 years now,
yes. What's
his name? Isaac. Isaac Berman, yes. They were very nice to us. We started working, and they had a factory, and we worked for my aunt, me and my mom. And I went to school at night, because my mom said, you gotta go to school because you gotta learn. And then after 49, Henry came. We used to correspond, and he came in 1951, and that's when we got married. On June 23rd, 1951, we got married. And of course, there was a little struggle with me and my mom because, you know, it was hard to make ends meet because we started like from the scratch. Eventually, you know, my mom always lived with us, even after we got married, because I wouldn't let my mom go any place. And we lived in the Bronx in a very nice building.
And what did you do?
And after I went to school, I went to look for a job, and I got a job in an office after I could speak English. Because my girlfriend said to me, why do you have to work in a factory? And I saw she was right, and I went and worked in an office, and gradually worked myself up to be a full-charge bookkeeper. But of course, in the meanwhile, I had my daughter.
What's her name?
Her name is Lori.
When was she born?
Lori was born on April 17, 1956.
And then you had another
And then I had my son, which was born on April 15, on my birthday, 1959. And I was home for 11 years. I didn't work till they went to school full time. And they always had my mother to come home, so they didn't come to an empty apartment. It was tough. Henry had to work three jobs, but eventually, you know, we survived.
And you have a grandchild?
I have two grandchildren. I have Rachel and I have Brooke, which is 2.5, and Rachel is 11. And my son, my daughter is a... You want to know what they do or you don't?
Sure, I do.
My daughter is a psychiatric social worker, but now she's with the School of Board of Education, and my son is a doctor.
What kind of doctor?
He's a psychiatrist, but right now he's working for a pharmaceutical company. And thank God we survived and we're here.
If you had to guess or have an opinion, which I suppose you do, as to why you survived, what would that opinion be?
Just destiny. We had years to live, and we lived. I strongly believe in whatever is destined for you, that's what's going to happen. You had to be in the right place at the right time, and you have to be lucky.
What do you think can be done to prevent a horror like the Holocaust from occurring again?
You have to educate people, to tell them what happened, it should never happen again, because it can happen to anybody. It's not only the Jews. Another time they might pick another, you know, another race, another religion, and say, decide that this is not good and this is not right. That's why people have to be educated, to know that everybody is equal. Everybody is a person. Everybody has a right to live and to exist.
Are you ever afraid now?
I'm afraid now.
Are you?
Sometimes when I read the paper and I see what's happening, I fear that, God forbid, could happen again. But I hope to God it won't, that people should hear and learn of whatever happened in the past and should learn from it and be more tolerant of other people. Because, you know, you never know. You never know what's coming.
You never do.
No.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Tape 4, interview of Eva Safferman.
This is a picture made in Lodz, Poland, and on the left is my grandmother. Towards the right is, I believe, my cousins and somebody's husband, I don't know. And on the very right is an aunt of ours.
Do you know any of their names?
Yeah, my grandmother, Bruchalaya Berman. And I think the blonde one is Rivkala, and the dark-haired one is Hanala. And the other one, I think it's Basha, I'm not sure. This is a picture of my father, Zachary Zisman Zachariasz, in Lodz, Poland, taken before the war. He was wearing a nice fur coat because it must have been winter at that time. This is a picture of my father, Zachariasz, my mother, Hanka, and me, taken in Lodz before the war. I was kind of sad because I wanted something and they didn't want to buy it for me, I guess. That's why the long face. This is a picture made in Sweden after the war. And it is my mother, it's my current husband, Henry, and me. Made in Sweden after the war in Borås. This picture was made in Sweden on the day of my leaving Sweden for America. That's the fancy hat that I bought so I look beautiful in the United States.
Who are you with?
I was here with my then boyfriend, Henry.
Is that the boat that you were getting onto?
Yes, this is the Gripsholm. This is a picture, our wedding picture, Henry and me, in Bronx, New York, on June 23rd, 1951.
Where were you married?
We were married in the Bronx, in Beth Shalom or Beth something like this, I don't know. Was in the Bronx.
Who did he look like?
He looked like Gregory Peck. These are my children, Lori and my son, Alan. When Lori must have been maybe 4 and Alan was 1 year old. It was made in the Bronx. This is my son, Alan, with my granddaughter, Brooke, when she was born, and my granddaughter, Rachel, on the left. This is my daughter, Lori. She went to visit the house that we used to live in the Bronx before we came to New Jersey. This is my granddaughter, Brooke, and my daughter-in-law, Meryl, took this picture in the lobby of their apartment. Brooke is 2.5 years old. This is my husband, Henry, and my granddaughter, Rachel, in front of the house.
When?
Last year. 1995. This picture was taken on the deck of my house. We had a little picnic, and from left is me, and my mom is in the middle, and my husband is on the right. We're having a good picnic with lots of hamburgers.